Check, test, hello. Okay, so thank you all for coming. We're here from the Institute for Applied Autonomy. We are an anonymous cooperative robotics collective that stems from being in an environment in which research is completely dominated by projects which either serve consumer optimization or civil subjugation, i.e., you know, the military or selling shit. So any of you who were at Jello's presentation, I can just cite his and we can like get over having to say all that stuff again, as he said it's so good. So we're mostly comprised of engineers, computer scientists, artists, designers, cultural theorists. Everybody just donates whatever it is, the skill that they have, however much time they have. Nobody gets paid. We don't have any funding sources. It all comes from out of the pocket. The main initiative that we've been working on over the course of the last 2 years, we started in 98, is called Contestational Robotics. We've got two essays here available for you and a brochure describing all our projects thus far. Contestational Robotics was developed as a way of bringing kind of technologically augmented protest into the streets. It was developed kind of parallel to this idea that's come up a lot lately of electronic civil disobedience. And it was developed alongside of some of the early electronic civil disobedience groups. We were concerned with the fact that sort of leaves out the real world, it leaves out the real public space, it leaves out the space in which people actually see each other face to face, and which real solidarity gets constructed. We were a little worried about people going home and into their own individual little cubicles and participating in these acts of civil disobedience, you know, outside of any like real world localized framework. So our robots take place in the streets. Enough said. So I guess the first project we're going to be talking about is Little Brother. Little Brother was a propaganda robot developed for distributing subversive literature to people who might otherwise not take it from someone like myself or you, based on how you look, on what you have to say. So this is a way of getting people to look at your message without even realizing they are. My apologies. If we could just run that tape, and I'll read a little bit from our research paper. We do publish, by the way, and we present it at the International Conference on Robotics and Automation, IEEE conference last year, so for whatever that means to you. So do we have anything on the screen? Can we turn that down? The audio track to this is largely useless, and I can't see anything. So I'll just tell you about it instead of reading it. So Little Brother was based on the aesthetics of early sci-fi movies in America and the super cute Japanese toy aesthetic. In particular, the Japanese toy aesthetic is designed specifically to pull people into a product who might otherwise not have a reason to, a la Hello Kitty. And it's a highly fetishized object. So we developed this robot. It uses has two sonars in its neck, or a sonar pair, so it can determine how far away you are, and uses its high-pitched childlike voice to lure you in to take a pamphlet. We don't supply the content for these pamphlets, typically. We prefer to collaborate with other activist groups who actually have something to say. In this case, we collaborated with a group called the Society for Reproductive Anachronisms. They're a grassroots organization that's developed in response to technological and scientific mediation of the reproductive process. So they have such campaigns as nomadic promiscuity as a way of ensuring a diverse gene pool. So it tilts its head, so it can look at people. It's battery operated, can run for something like 10 hours on big lead acid cells, far longer than the average human activist is going to stand on a corner. As you know, it's snowing in this case, so this is really adverse conditions, but the robot's not fazed. We found that the robot was ideal at targeting the most difficult to reach target audiences, that being children and senior citizens. Unfortunately, on this film, we don't have the choicest footage of a seven-year-old child taking a stack of pamphlets and giving them to his grandmother to put into her purse. I mean, she's great. It was so close. That's much more hang time than the average activist would get, I tell you. So if you could stop the tape, that was pretty much the end of Little Brother. And could we have the lights so I can see again? There's little. I didn't bring my. I guess I have a lighter or something. Hey, thank you. So we have a research paper about Little Brother that talks about our cuteness obnoxious scale and all the other technical aspects. It mentions the privatization of public space has had a chilling effect on activist communications. As malls replace marketplaces and parking lots replace parks, distributing unsanctioned information is becoming an increasingly high-risk endeavor. Once protected by free speech laws, activists now face fines, imprisonment, and bodily harm for distributing their literature on what had previously been considered public property. So, enter the robots. The second robot we developed is what you see here on the table, and what we entitled this presentation seems to be kind of the poster child for contestational robotics. This is the robotic graffiti writer. Graffiti writer was developed initially as a tactical robot. We were basically following right along line of the research that our colleagues were doing for the Defense Department and DARPA. The idea being that in an environment that's too dangerous for a human to operate in, you send in a robot to do the dirty work. Well, in this case, graffitiing in public areas, especially during high-profile events, even during the day, or extremely unsanctioned spaces, I guess I should say, such as shopping malls, federal buildings, public squares, the robot is ideally suited to this environment. One of its earliest actions was just in Pittsburgh, just graffitiing down the middle of the street. That was just its first demo. But we realized that when we did that, the robot attracted all the attention, and the human teleoperator was absolutely clear. And I mean, you could stand in the public with a remote control, and nobody would see you. You were a ghost because, like, there's a fucking robot riding on the pavement, like 20 feet away. So that was our first clue that we were on to something good. Allegedly, it was taken to Washington, D.C. by some unnamed members, operatives of the IAA technical or tactical wing. I don't even know who those guys are. But it was brought to the A Capitol building. And it was deployed on the pavement, and the car sort of, this is a very elaborate plan. The car, the getaway vehicle, would drive along the road while the robot was sent into the danger zone, drop its message, get out, car would pick it up, take off in the clear. It sort of worked. From what I understand, the driver of the vehicle, as the robot began writing, and you could hear the robot writing, headlights appeared behind the car, and a booming voice telling him to turn off the engine, which he did. And one of DC's finest came over and, you know, told the operatives to put the item onto the sidewalk, which we did. And he stood there, and it was a little different than what you see here, because we had this nice form-fitting black cape over the can, so you couldn't really see the cans. And he asked, by the way, are there any federal agents in the room? Okay, there's just one in the back, that's fine. He asked us what it is. We told him it was a robot we built, or they told him. And he asked us what we were doing, and we told him we were shooting a movie. The smell of paint was still thick in the air, but he was unable to kind of put the whole picture together. Which, by the way, in fluorescent orange across the steps of the U.S. Capitol building read, "Voting is futile." and the operatives were informed to leave the area and drove to Philadelphia. So that was our first clue, our second clue, that if we had a robot, we could basically get away with anything at this point in time. Which started a new initiative we were calling Rogues Gallery, which is where we would put the technology in the hands of civilians and allow them to write graffiti, whatever content they wished. We will not add a filtration system. We add actually a, gulp, as the police officer used the robot to write "We Love Pittsburgh Police," for instance. But what Rogues Gallery was all about was putting people in the position of committing crimes that otherwise would not, using this technology. And we're able to go all over several cities, worldwide now, actually. It's been to Europe twice and is going back in the fall. And put the technology in the hands of businessmen, homeless people. You'll see this all in the video. But the point was that never, ever were we turned down. And we were able to blanket cities in graffiti of all matter, things that we would never think of writing. And 5 minutes later, we're gone, the robot's gone, but the graffiti's there for a month, 2 months. It's not super permanent. It's not like enamel paint. This is the stuff that the construction crews use, because the last thing we want to do is kind of build more monuments than are already out there. So these are nice, temporal messages that are kind of burned into people's consciousnesses for a time and then go away. So I guess now would be the appropriate time to run the video. If we could hit play again, there's probably going to be a really uncomfortable black leader on the tape. I'll have to fill the air. That was our first logo, and it was somewhere. Wow, cool! I have a light. That was our first logo. This is our second logo.
Applied Autonomy was founded in 1998 as a technological research and development organization dedicated to the cause of individual and collective self-determination. Our mission is to study the forces and structures which affect self-determination and to develop technologies which extend the autonomy of human activists. This initiative, known as contestational robotics, inverts the traditional relationship between robots and authoritarian power structures by meeting the needs and budgets of resistant forces. The current focus of this initiative is the Robotic Graffiti Writer. Graffiti Writer was developed as a tactical street weapon which could further extend the abilities of human activists to participate in real-world public acts of subversion while retaining essential out-of-range anonymity. Graffiti Writer is a teleoperated robot which employs a custom-built array of spray cans to write linear text messages on the ground at a rate of 15 kilometers per hour. The robot can be deployed in any highly controlled space or public event from a remote location. Once Graffiti Writer is navigated into place, a push button triggers the high-speed printing process. The robot is then navigated to a secluded pickup area or is simply considered a worthy sacrifice in the name of robotic objection. In addition to these covert applications, the Graffiti Writer project brings the power of mediated criminal experience to a wide audience of cultural participants. Recently, IAA researchers deployed the Graffiti Writer in a series of public space experiments. This field testing revealed that in nearly 100% of the cases, a given agent of the public would willingly participate in high-profile acts of vandalism, given the opportunity to do so via mediated telerobotic technology. Test cases who violated local ordinances governing graffiti in public areas included students, municipal workers, homeless people.
We're filming a movie called Johnny Robot starring a homeless guy.
Girl Scouts and others. The Institute for Applied Autonomy is currently accepting applications for its spring and summer 2000 research program.
Thank you. So that's Graffiti Writer. Right now, the current research in progress is a robot, for lack of a better name, we're calling Street Writer. And this is about exactly four times the width of Graffiti Writer, but is mounted on the bottom of an existing car. So it's a different tactical paradigm. It's not about the thing looks like a robot so we can get away with it. It's about the thing doesn't look like a robot so we can get away with it. The first iteration will probably be mounted on the back of a 62 black Cadillac, just because I really like that idea. It'll be 20 cans wide. It'll be able to print simple graphics, which Graffiti Writer is not really able to do other than like smiley faces and checkerboards. It'll be able to print texts that are legible from the driver's vantage, you know, like those fire lane messages. It'll also be able to print text, you know, horizontally, like Graffiti Writer does, that'll be visible from tall buildings and low-flying aircraft. And that's pending research. We hope to be finished with that in August, and we'll bring it to a town near you. So that's it for like the currently in progress, ongoing, actually building shit kind of research. But we've got some conceptual sort of vaporware projects on the horizon, which is actually probably more critical to you guys, because that's why we're here. We're sort of, these are more AI-based, more software-intensive projects. And so I'll just give you a brief rundown of what we're talking about. And if you have these skills, approach us afterwards, and we would love to work with you. If you don't have the skills, but you're just interested, that's great. But we really need people that have the skills already. So basically, what we're talking about is modes of inverse surveillance, turning surveillance systems back on themselves or using material that's already there to monitor the monitors. So you could effectively call this cop watch. There's kind of two strains that we're talking about here. One is automated monitoring of police radios, using voice recognition, searching for police codes and addresses. It's a very noisy signal, so this is a big problem for speech recognition right now. But if we can overcome that, because it is such a limited vocabulary we're talking about, you can actually build a real-time map of where police are being called to intervene at any given time, and you can make that map publicly available. You can also make it available on a per user basis, i.e. you have an 800 number, you call that number, you give the number a time and like, you know, a quadrant of the city and a pager number, and you can be paged if there's going to be an intervention occurring in your area, and give you about a 30-second head start. So this has obvious applications to high school kids who want to drink, graffiti writers, you know, all manner of what do you call them, delinquent youths and criminals and everybody else that has good ideas and just don't want cops around, right? I mean, that's so that's one project. The other another strain of that is simply visual identification of. Automated visual identification of police officers based on their uniforms and their vehicles. This is partly inspired by projects such as the Video Surveillance and Monitoring Project, which is going on at a number of different universities and is basically just automated monitoring of public space where, you know, via video cameras where persons can be isolated in the image from other vehicles, signed an ID, potentially, you know, you triangulate their face and, you know, do some facial recognition on it as well. We're not really interested in people wandering on public spaces. We're more interested in watching the cops. So that's another project, if anybody has any experience in video signal analysis. That's pretty much all I got here. Oh, well, we got a bunch of stuff, and we're going to be setting up a table out there right afterwards. I don't know if we'll be able to stay in here, but we've got brochures that describe all the projects. It's got our web address on it, which is www.appliedautonomy.com. Both of the videos are there in a number of different streaming formats and QuickTime. And there's pictures. All the papers are there. And we've also got these things, which is kind of a low-tech alternative. Got all this technology, and there's other ways of getting at these problems. These are ads that are for those ads that are appearing on the back of gas pump handles everywhere. Really interesting paradigm. A company called Filboard, if you go to filboard.com, they'll tell you all about how valuable it is to have a captive audience for 3 minutes while they pump their gas tank and go to the snack shop. So these little stickers here, you can cut out, peel off, paste over the existing ad, and it's a public service announcement from Exxon explaining how to use their fuel in the manufacture of Molotov cocktails. beyond that, I don't know what kind of time schedule we're running on or who like we're screwing by being here. I'd like to answer questions. What's that? Oh, excellent. Excellent. Good call. So I don't know if we should do questions here or outside, but there's some hands up in the air, so I'm going to call them.
Okay. First question is from me. How much does this robot cost in case you have to sacrifice it to the...
Well, sacrificing it would... Right.
Than
when you can manufacture them. Very, very true. In terms of parts, we're just looking at like $1,000 over the course of, it's like 8 months to build. And there's several iterations in there. So if we had to do it again, the parts price would actually be probably closer to half that. But that's not the real sink. The sink is the time and the skills it takes to build it. And that, we can't just like replicate. Although we try to make as much of the information about it publicly available as possible. Source code, schematics, little things that we learn, but obviously the machining skills here is a pretty rarefied skill, and it's not something you're going to find, anywhere. Yeah, okay, it's basically field programmable. We used to have to lug around a laptop with us, program in a message, send it in, it'll print that message as many times as you want it. But we reduced things down recently so that now all we have is a Hewlett-Packard 48G running a terminal. And that's all we need. I think you had your hand up before. I mean like robot napping?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that was we actually brought that up in the original paper, which is one of the reasons Little Brother is so big. I know what it is to lug that thing around. it would be very simple to also put just a little switch on the bottom of it so that when it is lifted off the ground, it triggers a siren. Or we thought about doing the same thing. Little Brother could empty the cans, when it's lifted off the ground by somebody who doesn't have the right key. So yeah, there is theft deterrence that we could do. We just haven't had the problem yet.
What on that could you not replicate by going and buying the $40 RE and Radio Shack and slapping on to sort of...
Well, it's the slapping on part that's a lot harder than it sounds.
There's a lot of manufacturing that went in that, and a lot of it was done with the key and a lot of it was done with the cost.
Okay, there's a camera, there's the antenna box, there's the electronics in the central part of the body. The chassis is the tough part to build, this whole suspension system you see here. The system of the solenoids, these little electromagnets that actuate the cans. It's a precision device. The car originally, just so you know, was a clodbuster, but we've basically reduced it down to its wheels, motors, and gearboxes, and that's it. There's nothing else original on here. So getting a clodbuster will get you there, but it's not even halfway. It was our experience anyway, but good luck to you.
If I may ask you, to repeat the questions?
I'm sorry. Okay. That question, if you couldn't figure it out was what's the hard part, I think, is that question. Hands? In the back? Oh, well, we open source everything to begin with. We don't keep any secrets, if that's what you mean. So we're more interested in just getting it out.
Well, I don't mean that secrets as a message to try to get out. I mean, it's a secret as a reflector user to get the message
out. We're using to get the message out. You mean like identities? Oh no, like well, okay, ripping off the idea? Is that sort of the question?
No, I'm trying to say that somebody like if you have to sacrifice a robot, somebody has to actually create the robot and now they have it, they can take it home, reverse engineer it, or whatever.
Oh, how somebody potentially countering the technology? Well, I mean, the effective countermeasure is like, you know, paint-proof pavement, right? Okay. I mean, I suppose it's possible, but they really wouldn't need, if they were interested in developing a counter system, they wouldn't really need to steal it because, like I say, we do keep everything, all the information is public. If somebody really took that kind of interest in us, I think that would be a very good sign, and we could probably figure out a way around that. Any what kind of protection?
Electromagnetic?
No, none at all. It's all wide open. Who the hell's going to sniff this? Okay, this is a good question. He's asking...
How do you protect that idea? Not the machine, not the source code, that idea.
Right, he's asking about the potential for the business world to co-opt this idea and kind of, you know, these things end up everywhere or like, you know, you go to Epcot Center and there's robots printing on the ground. Yeah, I mean... Yeah, you know, we're not going to copyright this. Like, we're not going to trademark anything. That's sort of a part of the problem, or a part of the solution. I don't know which. If these things were manufactured and available at Radio Shack, would that be a good thing? I don't know. I kind of don't think so. You know, I think it works because there's only a couple. But you know, if they're everywhere, you know, you just see Pepsi ads on the ground, and that's no good. I mean, have you seen these machines on the beaches now that print ads in the sand? All right, think about that.
Well, I guess in that case, you'll have the chance to develop a different robot that's just a stack of black paint.
Right, right, that just paints over their messages, right. Right. It's true. If somebody actually manufactures something similar enough to it, there is this, you know, whole new realm of hacking possibilities for us, right? Because right now, there ain't a whole lot in the way of off-the-shelf robotics that actually do anything. So when we get there, things will get more interesting. We did want to run a demo of the robot. We wanted to do it in here, so maybe now's the time, and if you have any real questions or want to talk anymore, we'll be here for like at least another couple hours over in the other room. We'll have a table set up. So, yeah, if you want to, like, the people in the front row and maybe even, I think it's just the people in the front row, they could, like, grab their chairs and kind of take them to the sides and open up a space here. We're going to roll down some paper. Oh, and by the way, it's always our policy when we're doing these things in public spaces that we really hate coming up with the content on our own. So I was kind of hoping like Emmanuel would be around, you know, his shtick. But hey, anybody can come up with a good message. Not your name, not a message for your girlfriend. Something good. Yeah, fuck the MPAA, something like that. I wonder if you can take that.